In this video, I'm going to show you how to use the factory design pattern within Java. We're going to talk about the simple factory pattern, also called the factory method pattern. And then we're also going to talk about the full factory pattern, or what's typically referred to as factory pattern. We're going to be a candy store that sells different types of candies. And I'm going to show how you can make that candy store use the factory pattern in order to make the candy objects. Let's go ahead and get right into it. All right, I already have a fair amount of code written here. To go through it, we have our main class and main method, where we are creating this string of text, which represents the type of candy that we want our candy store to make. We're instantiating our candy store, and then we're calling this sell candy method. So if we follow where sell candy goes, that takes us right here. And we can see that we take in the candy type string, which in our case is Starburst. And then we have this switch expression here where we have the type of candy that we are trying to make. And then we have different cases for whether we want to make a gumdrop or a starburst, or if we had something that we didn't expect, then we'll throw an illegal argument exception with that message. So now let's look at our candy object. So we have an abstract class with two abstract methods, sweetness and name. I could have made this an interface rather than an abstract class. Potato, potato. In this case, I made an abstract class. And what I've got here is two implementations of my abstract class. The gumdrop class and the starburst class. So what I would expect is when the string is starburst, I should create a starburst object. And if we run the code, that's exactly what we see. We sold a starburst, which is 5 units of sweetness. I could change this to gumdrop and rerun it. And in this case, we sold a gumdrop, which is 10 units of sweetness. All right, so it seems like the code is working, so what really needs to change? Well, I'm glad you asked. If you scroll down to the candy store, I see two potential issues with this. The first thing is that my candy store shouldn't really have to create candy objects. I feel like my candy store should just have to say, hey, get me the candy I requested. I shouldn't have to know the details of how the candy object is constructed. That really violates the single responsibility principle. It shouldn't be my job to have to construct the candies, just give them to me. And then likewise, what happens if I add new candies in here? Then I'm gonna have to add new cases in this switch expression. And that violates the open-close principle. When I add new candies to my store, why should I have to change my sell candy logic? Shouldn't I just be able to have a generic method, which is get me the candy I want and I'm gonna do something with it? This is where the factory pattern comes in. Basically what we're gonna do is we need to decouple the creation logic of these candy objects from the candy store class, because the candy store class shouldn't have to do it. And if we want to follow the single responsibility principle, then what we can do is we can make a class whose sole responsibility is object creation, in this case, candy objects. So to do that, let's create a new class. We'll call it Candy Factory. And we don't want anyone to extend this one, so we'll call it a final class. And what we want to do in this factory is let's make a public static method that returns a candy object called getCandy. And then it's going to take in the type of candy. And then we can basically copy this logic over. So we want to return the switch expression. And then in the candy store class, we can do candy factory. Dot get candy with our candy type. All right, so what we just did, this is an example of a simple factory, or also known as the factory method design pattern. And how it works is you have a class whose sole responsibility is object creation. Therefore, it is a factory. It is producing these objects. And now if I need to add in a new candy type, I just change this one class. I don't have to change my candy store class. And I can have the open-close principle because the candy store class is open for extension because it can handle new different types of candy, but it's closed for modification because I don't have to actually change it in order to have it be extended. Now, you could argue that the candy factory class is violating the open-close principle, but it's difficult to completely get away from the open-close principle as you add new variants, so that's kind of a limitation of the simple factory. But what I will say is that when you're using the factory pattern, starting out with the factory method design pattern is often your best friend, because it's really simple to use, it's simple to understand, and it doesn't really get into a trap you can easily get into, which is over design. And a real problem with over design is thinking through too much of a solution, overcomplicating your code and abstracting it more than it needs to be. The beauty of the simple factory is that it is simple. And there is nothing wrong with keeping code simple. That is something you should try to abide by at all times. Now, a lot of folks would say that this is an example of the factory pattern within Java. And if you want to consider the factory pattern also a simple factory, then sure, you could call it that. The factory pattern takes this a step further. And what it does is it creates another level of abstraction. And that is, instead of a single method being able to construct whether we're creating a candy object, we create individual classes that are responsible for creating the object types we want. So to go back to a full factory pattern, let's go back to where we were previously. All right, so we're back to where we started. And what we want to do differently this time is, instead of creating an individual method that is going to be the central source of creating our candy objects, we're going to delegate that to subclasses of the candy store class. So to do that, let's make the candy store abstract. Now we need an abstract method that returns a candy object called getCandy. And instead of using this switch expression, we're just going to call getCandy. And one important thing you'll notice here is we don't need to indicate the type of candy anymore. So I don't need to indicate it within the sellCandy method either. Now let's create a class called gumdropStore. And it's going to extend candy store. And when we extend candy store, we need to implement the getCandy method. And the getCandy method, in the case of the gumdrop store, is going to return a new gumdrop. And then likewise, let's do a Starburst store. And the Starburst store is going to return a Starburst. And then now what we need to do is we need to instantiate, instead of the candy store, we want to instantiate the Starburst and the gumdrop store objects. So we can create a final candy store. We'll just call it store one is a gumdrop store. And then store two will be the Starburst store. And then we can call store 1.sellCandy and store 2.sellCandy. And we no longer need the candy type. And if we run the code, we can see that store 1 is selling the gumdrop as we would expect. And then store 2 is selling the Starburst like we would expect. So this is an example of a true factory pattern. What you have is you have complete decoupling of the object types that you want constructed and the business logic for using those objects. This does come with a lot of overhead, and if you don't need it, then you shouldn't implement the full factory, because the factory method design pattern might be good enough. Some people call the factory method design pattern just an idiom, and I can see that argument because it's not the full factory pattern, but often when I'm using factory or I'm thinking of using it, I just default to a simple factory until I know I need something more full-fledged than that. And the full factory pattern still doesn't avoid the problem of needing to identify which concrete instance to create. And that's because what I'm showing here is I'm making an instance of the gumdrop and of the Starburst store. What would usually happen is we'd get a request object which indicates which of these stores we want to use. So we can't avoid the logic for selecting which concrete instance we want to create, but at least what we're doing is we are decoupling it from other parts of the code so that you can more easily test it and you can isolate business logic in very complex applications. Bottom line, use what you need, don't use what you don't need. I see a lot of times people could have used a factory and didn't, and they have this class that just has way too many responsibilities, And then I see other people who completely overdesign their code and have all this unnecessary abstraction, and it makes it really hard to trace through and read the code. You have to find that middle ground. And for me, that is using the simple factory most of the time, and then using a full factory when I really need it. And when you need something more than a full factory, there's even something called an abstract factory, which is an additional layer of abstraction beyond the full factory, which we could talk about in a future video. And that was an overview of the factory design pattern within Java. If you found that video interesting, or if you want to learn more about other design patterns within Java, I would highly recommend you read a book on software design patterns. Or if you want to hear another example, check out this video right here, which covers the singleton pattern within Java. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a good rest of your day, and I hope to see you next time. Take care.